Scarborough's Little Angels formed in 1987, and even before signing their record deal, they toured America with top rock guitarist Yngwie Malmsteen. Since those days, they've released two albums and had several hit singles. Last year, after a break of almost 18 months, the band launched themselves once again into the charts with the single Too Much, Too Young from their just-released third album, Jam.
The last gig we did, I think it was at the New York Ritz Club, and it was about a year and a half, 2 years ago. And it just took us a long time since that time to write the songs which we wanted to write, you know? And we were going through a lot of sort of personal trauma in our private lives and, you know, we had to sort of rediscover ourselves as a band. We had to get a new drummer. And, you know, we wanted to spend ages getting the new songs as good as possible. And it was kind of a really frustrating and boring time, because doing gigs is what you really, it was what we're about, you know, getting out there and meeting people and stuff. But it was a kind of necessary thing to do. And we've come through it, you know. We're still here. Band in Scarborough, we were always constantly looking for somewhere to rehearse because we were so noisy and so loud. We kept getting kicked out of everywhere, you know, that we'd be rehearsing. So we figured the only way we could get around the problem was like rehearsing in the middle of nowhere. So here we are in the middle of nowhere. This is Rillington, and if no one's heard of it, it's sort of in the middle of nowhere, you know. And the nearest other house, I think, is about 15 miles away. We just turned up at this place and said to the farmer, you know, hello, we're a heavy metal band, can we rehearse in your farm? We'll give you a tenner a week. And he said, yeah, sure, you know, do it. And this is the barn you can see behind me, and the noise just comes straight out of it, you know, and they'd be sat there having the Sunday dinner and stuff. We'd be like going through some rocking tunes, and they're cool, you know, they don't mind at all.
The first gig we ever did was, apart from sort of like the gigs we did at sixth form, just in the classrooms, because we used to sort of perform at, you know, sixth form for the chaps there. But our first gig we did was for the TSP Rock School competition, which was in Wakefield. So I suppose that could be considered as the first gig, but I can remember it vividly, yeah. I mean, then we went on to Theatre in the Round. Those were really a brilliant time for us, because that was like our first proper gigs, you know, really, because we had our own following, and all of a sudden it became apparent that we were becoming popular. So it was really good, you know.
The band's at the happiest when it's on the road. Because we've always done that from day one. We started off doing gigs around here and then moving it away. Studios are places that you've had to learn to become happy in. Whereas on the road, that's where we've always been happy. So we have a ball when we're out touring.
Yeah, that's the whole point of being in a band, really. I mean, a record is just something that sort of enables you to go on the road again. I'm going down, I'm going down.
Scarborough is a very small place, and we are kind of big fish in a small pond here. You know, I mean, when we go to the local shop here in Rillington, it's like, oh my God, it's them, you know, all this kind of stuff. And it's very difficult to like not really enjoy that kind of stuff. You know, like all this like adulation. When we go to London, nobody, you know, gives a shit about us. So that's why we like coming back to Scarborough, really, to show off.
There's only Robert Palmer, really, that came from Scarborough, and I think the Roots, I think, are some of it. So we were, like, the only other band, I mean, the only rock band, as far as I know, that I've ever got a deal from here. But I think that was really to our advantage, you know, because we used to rehearse with the sole intention of just becoming as good as we could, even though we weren't very good at the time. We just had this dream to get out of our town and just go everywhere else, because Scarborough to us was like our universe. But we wanted to break out of it, and you know, once we'd conquered Scarborough and played the 13th round and sold that out, we wanted to go further, and it became a kind of a bit of a catalyst, really, you know, to sort of move away. And so it was a really sort of good thing to happen to the town, I think, and to us, you know. Unlike the chains, radical your lover.
Auditioning loads of drummers to fill, like, you know, the stew, as it was.
As it was, yeah.
Sorry, I had to say that. And then me and Bruce came back up here just for like a week or something, and we just got together with Max, who's been a mate of ours for years, and we just started playing, and we thought, what would we bother, why are we trying anyone else? Here's the answer, you know.
Yeah, we thought, originally we thought he didn't really have much experience, so we thought we needed someone who had, you know, an album under the belt and that kind of thing, but it didn't really work out like that, because we tried all these people and they just weren't very exciting, were they?
Nah, and the very fact that, you know, I've known him for 10 years and...
Yeah.
Yeah, he's come from the same place, means that he's slotted in like a brother.
Mm. Mike left to join the cult, and Christmas was coming up again. Seems to all happen at Christmas, doesn't it? And I got a call from our manager, Kevin Nixon, and he said, the lads have been asked to do the Jim Will Fix It show at Christmas. A little boy had written in and said, can you fix it for me to play drums with a rock band? You know, it wasn't me, by the way. And I said, yeah, I'll help you out, you know, if you haven't got a drummer and what have you. And so we went down and did that. And they also asked me to rehearse up some new stuff for this new album, which is coming out fairly soon. And while we were doing that, they asked me to join, which was a nice surprise.
Most of the songs on this new record. We all write songs, but Toby's happened to be the best ones this time round. And we are a very much songs-orientated band, and, you know, total quality control. You know, we don't care who writes the songs, the best ones make it onto the record. And he's been through a lot of stuff, and out of his experiences, he's spawned these songs. So they have actually come out quite quickly, but over a long period of time, if you see what I mean.
This record is a lot simpler, a lot more direct. It's got a lot more ingenuity, and I think a lot more intelligence. I think we're trying to say things that actually mean something, but at the same time don't over force the point, you know. And I think that's what I feel about it. I just think it's generally got a vibe of a sort of seriousness about it, you know. And I really like that. And that was my own personal kind of what I wanted to do with it. I wanted to make it more, just more intellectual, but in a good way, in a kind of more sort of just loose away, you know, make it more fun as well. It's difficult to describe. It's kind of looseness with intelligence, I don't know. But it's basically jammed, a bit more jammy, and that's why we call the album Jam, because we felt as if the performances were far more liquid and a lot more instant, you know. Really boring bit in between the support band and the main band going on, and it's usually half an hour, and a lot of kids kick their heels and maybe sort of, I don't know, go and get a drink or something. So we just kind of felt like we wanted to just give them a little insight to how the record was made, because like how I've described, the record was a lot looser and it was a lot more fun making it. You know, we shot hours and hours of Hi8's video 8 footage, and we just wanted to cobble it together and put the funniest bits, you know, and the bits of swearing and all the rest of it on there, and show the kids this is how we made our record. And I don't think it's going to be available for retail at any point, which that wasn't in the point. It's just to have a bit of fun and say, oh, this is how we do it.
Particular TV show which we did, it was actually the James Whale show, and I think it was Bruce's birthday actually, so we all got a bit merry on the way to the studio. We're swigging champagne driving from Scarborough to Leeds, wherever it is, and we're all a bit far gone by the time we got there, and we turned up and there's all this gear ready for us, and so James had some guests on, you know, it was usually something like Linda Nolan or someone like that, you know, and some fat comedian, and he said just go and play, you know. So we got up and we did a song.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Little Angels and Young Gods.
And all of a sudden, Mike decided to sort of trash his kit, which is fair enough, because he often used to do that. So he just leapt up and started smashing all his drums, and Bruce started smashing his guitars and all this kind of stuff. And that's fine, you know, that's cool. But the kit was actually a hired kit. And the guy who owned the kit was sat at home watching the TV with his girlfriend. He was sat there going, that's my kit on the telly, that is. Like this, like dead proud that his kit's on the telly, you know. And the next thing he sees Mike like jumping up and down on his bass drum, and he's on the phone going, f***ing hell, that's my kit, you know. And so, but we did buy him a new one. The story has a happy end. You young gods! You young gods! Stand the man's voice for your eyes. No surrender and no compromise. Where desire is bye. Have our attitudes changed? I don't know. Have they changed?
Well, I think, you know, again, from being a fan before, when the first album came out, you know, it was like, wow, we've got a record deal and all this, and you know, they went a bit, you know, pie in the sky, but why not? You know, they'd done really well.
What? You cheeky git.
Yeah, they did. You did. You all did a bit. But anyway.
My attitude has become, I suppose, more ambitious in many respects. But at the same time, I've also I understand that the business is a very fickle thing, and all the trappings apart from the music, I don't like to involve myself in personally because I think it's a bunch of crap. You know, it's the peripheral things that really stop you from sometimes attaining what you need to, because it takes over. You know, for me, it's the music's the most important thing, and playing and just getting better. Wind up sleeping in an empty room, a bottle of wine, the smell of cheap perfume just
makes me think of our yesterdays. I look back like 3 or 4 years ago and think, well, yeah, how embarrassing now. So I suppose in 20 years' time we probably will, but the point is, if your heart's in it at the time, then...
We'll probably be squeezing ourselves into spandex for a reunion tour or something, yeah, around Europe.
Zimmer frames out.
I think I could probably say wearing a ruffled shirt and a tailcoat and having my hair boofed up with airspray was probably a huge mistake in the early days. But thinking about it, I think it probably made me sort of think, well, you look a complete stool in that. So I'll deboof my hair and wear a T-shirt, you know. So I think you just got to learn by it, you know. And growing up in public is always a really incredibly difficult thing to do, because you make huge mistakes and people laugh at you. But it's really nice proving them wrong. Sleeping in an empty room, a bottle of wine, the smell of cheap perfume just makes me think of our yesterdays. It's hard enough seeing you with another man, but I don't want to cry than a grown man can. And I'd sad to say that it's rain again. Important to sort of learn as we went along, I think. And I think, you know, when we do attain the heights we want to get to, which we are determined to reach, I think people will look back and probably view it as a far more natural and honest progression, because I think people will say, well, they were complete brats in 1987, but look at them, they're really good now, so it doesn't matter. You know, it's a growing period. And that to me is more important.